opinions expressed by the host, callers, or guests are not those of DreamStreamRadio.com, JAL Media, its advertisers, sponsors, employees, volunteers, or affiliated companies. All content is owned by the presenter of each program and are bound by certain rules and regulations set forth by DreamStream Radio. Any contest aired on any program broadcast on DreamStream Radio are encompassed by the following rules. One winner per family per household. Employees and their immediate family members, volunteers, advertisers, or affiliated companies are not eligible to play or win. Participants are entitled to one prize every 30 days and agree to allow their voice and likeness to be used in any means of transmission for later station promotional broadcast. DreamStreamRadio.com.
Feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Moebanshee's Lair, rocking your world on DreamStreamRadio.com.
And welcome to Moebanshee's Lair on DreamStreamRadio.com. We work without a net. Tonight I have two guests. One is a pre-recorded interview with Susan Selfe. And the topic is Anthony Newley. Anthony Newley was an incredible actor. Most people remember him from Dr. Doolittle and all the different movies. I swear the man worked in so many movies. And I never considered him a great singer, but you don't have to be a great singer to end up being a great singer in the music industry. You have to have the gumption to get up and sing a song. And Anthony Newley had that gumption. I don't know where he got it from, but I didn't particularly think he was the greatest singer in the world. He was a good-looking kid when he was young. But Susan has written a book called Dear Tony, and it's a memoir. And we discussed Anthony Newley, and here's some things that I wanted to let everybody know. Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory came out in 1971. Anthony Newley was responsible for the lyrics of The Candyman, Cheer Up Charlie, I've Got a Golden Ticket, Pure Imagination, Oompa Loompa Doompa Dee Doo, and I Want It Now, The Wondrous Boat Ride. He wasn't credited, but he also wrote that. All his music has been sung by other people. And it's amazing to me because I was looking on whatever that thing is, that IMB, what tells you, you know, people using, you know, people, what they've been acting and all that jazz. And in 2014, he still was credited for The Tonight Show, even though he's been gone for a long time. He was credited because they used the Oompa Loompa song on The Tonight Show. And Mark Wahlberg and Kevin Nealon, evidently, they did something with the song. Strictly Come Dancing, he got credits for Feeling Good, a song he wrote, and that was used in it. Anthony Newley passed away from cancer back in the 70s. He had bladder cancer, and they got it. But when it comes back with a vengeance, and he passed away. Let me try to bring up some stuff. He was born in London. And he lied his way in. He attracted someone. He was working, bringing tea and such to this Italia Conti stage school, age 14. And he was bringing tea and stuff. And he was a gopher, what we call a gopher. Go for this, go for that. And he was discovered and put to work. He was The first Artful Dodger in 1948, and David Lean's Oliver Twist. And he did serve in the National Service, and he came back and he made movies. I think his huge legacy is his music. Even though he was an actor, I think that his legacy was his music. And here's a quote of his. "I'm the laziest son of a bitch who ever drew a breath. I'll sleep till one, and I'm always surprised when someone in blue rinse on a talk show says, 'You're a genius, Mr. Newley. You do so many things.' Tony Newley never realized his potential. He did things he should have done. That's why he says, 'I need it, Leslie Bruschi.'" That was his collaborator. He said he had plenty of ambition. He also had a couple of things to say. He was married to Joan Collins, and they broke up, but towards the end of their life, they got together. Susan Selfe is a personal friend of his, and after her mother's death, she decided to write a book about him. After we're done playing Susan, the music and Susan's interview, I'm going to have George Reis on, and George Reis has a drive-in, Monster Drive-In, and he's going to come on and talk to us about his love of the old monster movies. And on Saturday, April 25th at Riverside Drive-In on Route 66 and River Road, Vandergrift, PA, they're going to have Dawn of the Dead, Zombie, The House by the Cemetery, a whole bunch of things. And I know you're going to love it. I have a lot of, what do they call them, trailers from the movies. But I wanted you to hear a couple of the songs Anthony Newley had written. I hope everybody is safe from the storm that we had. This was a good storm. It gave us a good wallop, but it was by no means as bad as it could have been. And a lot of the newscasters are getting a lot of heat over it. And the reason I'm a little upset about that is we've become a society that doesn't ever think. We don't keep things ahead of time. We don't plan for anything. We kind of live day by day. And when I was young, you kept a pantry full of canned goods, canned milk, canned goods, in case the weather turned on you and you couldn't get to the store. You always were prepared. Yesterday, I knew snow was coming. I didn't know if it was going to be really, really bad like they were forecasting, or if we were going to dodge the bullet. And that's totally, it's all about barometric pressure and changing. All kinds of things change, and in a split second, something that was coming at you with the force of a freight train starts to slide over to the right, and suddenly it doesn't hit you, but it nails somebody else terribly. It's like a tornado. Weather is a tornado that can't be controlled. All you can do is, and I call it Mr. Spock wisdom, you give it the best guess you can. You give it the best guess. You watch what it's doing, and you try to figure out what it's going to do next. We are very lucky. We're very lucky we didn't get nailed the way we were going to. But February, we always do get storms. So everybody go out and get your pantries full now. Don't wait until the cupboards are bare and then run to the store and say there's no water, there's no milk, there's no this, there's no that. Go out and get yourself ready now. Winter isn't over, and we can get snow right up into March. So you should always be prepared and always, always have what you need for your animals. Check on your elderly. Make sure you're prepared. That's the first rule of survival. Make sure you work ahead of time and be prepared. I'm going to play another song that was written by Anthony Newley, but because of the rules of radio, I can't play songs he sang himself. You know, I can't play him singing them, and I can't play them if they're on the same albums. So it makes it difficult, but there is a little way around it. So I'm going to play another song, and then I'm going to go right into Susan Selfie and her interview. And I hope you guys are going to enjoy this. And I think you're going to be surprised at some of the songs this man wrote.
Dream, stream, radio.
All right, everybody, gather around. The candy man is here. Now, what kind of candy do you want? Sweet chocolate, chocolate malt, candy, gumdrops, anything you want. You've come to the right man because I'm the candy man. Who can take a sun?
Every Saturday night is filled with the greatest rock and roll on Rock and Roll's Greatest Hits, hosted by Johnny Bravo. At 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time every Saturday night, Bravo takes your requests and dedications while playing those hard-to-find favorites. Join us every Saturday night for the best of the 50s and 60s on Rock and Roll's Greatest Hits on DreamStreamRadio.com.
Okay. I want to welcome everybody. Our guest is on the phone. She's visiting America from England. She's from America, Susan Selfe. Welcome to the Lair.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Great. I'm hoping it's picking up your voice. Just say hello, everybody.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me.
Yes, it's picking you up just fine. You've written a Good. Book, Dear Anthony. Can you tell
yes,
everybody how, Dear Tony, tell everybody how you know or knew Anthony Newley?
Okay, I was a fan from an early age as a child at 9 years old after seeing him on Broadway with my parents in Roar of the Grease Paint. And then I came to England, as my dad was English, to do some business as a young woman, and met him for real, and we became close friends then for the next 27 years.
He was very kind to you. You had gotten a rejection for a job or something, and you
That's
were crying,
right.
And he was... Yeah, tell them that story real quick.
Okay. Well, I had gone for a job, which I thought was for a dancer, and it turned out to be an erotic dancer. And I was a young girl, and it kind of took me, you know, it did shock me. I mean, we're talking about the 70s when things weren't so open. And I came out of there so upset, and I looked over the road, and outside a cafe was Tony drinking tea, and I decided to go over after a little while because I was so nervous to ask for an autograph, and he actually invited me to have tea with him, and we sat and we talked for hours, and then we went for dinner, and a friendship blossomed.
He was a multi-talented guy. He was a good actor. He was a good singer, but he wrote music too. What would you say was his strong suit in personality?
I mean, he had the greatest personality. He was a natural comedian. He really was a genius. You know, he really was a genius. He was only educated to the age of 14, but you know, his first acting job, you know, got him praise. He could act. He could never read or write music, yet, you know, we know what he produced. You know, he was just great. You know, he was just great at everything.
It's been a while, so why write the book?
To be really honest, Mo, I wrote the book. I lost my mom 3 years ago, and I needed to do something. And I don't know, I had so many memories, and my mother knew him too, and it just seemed the right time. So the book is like in two parts, to be quite honest. It's about my childhood, you know, my journey to London, and then the love story with Anthony Newley. It helped me. I suppose it was my way to deal with the grief.
He was the first Artful Dodger to play on Broadway. Yes.
Mo, let me just stop you
there. Okay, go ahead.
He was not the Artful Dodger on Broadway. He was in the first Artful Dodger in David Lean's film of Oliver Twist with Alec Guinness.
Okay. Yeah. And then he wrote What Kind of Fool Am I? I don't have all my records in front of me because we've been trying to do this for months, and every time we did, something happened. And of course, something happened last night. So
yes,
I was actually asleep when you called.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
He didn't write music, you say, because he wrote helped write the music for Willy Wonka with Gene Wilder.
Oh, yes. I mean, but he could hear. That was where the genius lied. He could hear every tune in his head, all the different parts. He had it all up in his head, and he always had a pianist at hand, and he would say, this goes there. And, you know, and they would write. They would transcribe exactly what he could hear in his head. So all these wonderful songs, you know, Who Can I Turn To? He wrote the theme from, you know, Goldfinger, all the music for Willy Wonka.
Goldfinger,
you know, I mean,
yeah.
You know, and all this he could hear. You know, he was just really quite incredible, really incredible.
And you were friends right up until his death, and I'm not going to ask you how many years that was on air, but his cancer kind of took him by surprise.
Well, in 1985, he lost a kidney to cancer.
Right.
And he recovered really, really quickly and really well. And, you know, they were so confident they got it. But unfortunately, like many people, years later, it returned. And, you know, his words were, you know, I didn't have cancer. Cancer has me. So, you know, when it returned, it returned with a vengeance. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that's unfortunately how it happens. Mm-hmm. He was young when he passed away, right?
67, yes.
Yeah, that's young. Even back,
it is.
Back 10, 20 years, that's a young age. Mm-hmm. You made him a birthday cake, and in your book, you know, you talk about it was a pretty pathetic attempt at a birthday cake,
yes.
But he really loved it. Can you share that story?
Yes, it was, I mean, again, I won't say very much, but it was a milestone birthday. I celebrated with him, and he'd been out that day. He went to see his family. And I worked in a really sparse kitchen, too. The kitchen my grandma had in England was, you know, minimal. And I went and bought this cake mix and made my own icing, and it turned out, I mean, talk about blue. It was like royal blue, and I put balloons up in that, but, you know, he was just as happy with that cake, or made out that he was just as happy with that cake as if one had come from somewhere posh, you know, and we celebrated, and, you know, it was nice. It was special.
Mm-hmm. He suffered from depression.
Yes.
I don't know what it is about people who are geniuses. I guess the downtime kills them. I don't know what it is, but was he a drinker when he got depressed?
No, he wasn't. He cared for himself. It wasn't that, you know. He just would go into dark places. He wasn't a drinker, or at that point, you know, he was just, you know. I agree with what you said. I think, you know, I'm a therapist too, and I think most creatives get dark moods. I don't know what it is, but I don't know if it's the way our minds work or what, but, you know, creatives are prone to depression.
Yeah. How many minutes do we have before I have to let you go?
15.
15, okay. You weren't able to attend this funeral, right?
No, I didn't, no.
No,
that was in Florida. No. He passed away in Florida.
Yeah. He was married to Joan Collins. And I'm not going to ask any dirt because, I mean, you know, the man is dead. That's quite a step up for somebody who was born in England to a not wealthy family. During the Blitz, he was shipped out to a rural town to get him out of the bombing.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, that's how he was introduced to theater. But that is quite a match, Joan Collins. How did they meet?
Okay, well, I if I'm not mistaken, I mean, I know she actually attended seeing him in Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. And her date at the time was Robert Wagner, the actor Robert Wagner.
Wow.
And you know, as Joan says, you know, I think it's so very well documented. She thought Tony was cute, and she was at a stage in her life where she thought she'd like a family. And, you know, she thought he could provide everything. He had the looks, the brains, you know, and it was mutual. You know, he fell for her hook, line, and sinker, and she did the same for him. And they had, you know, 8 years together, 8 magical years. You know, and 2 beautiful children.
Mm-hmm. And so no hard feelings when they got divorced? I mean, was okay?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't a very pleasant divorce, but I think one of the most blessings in his life was that in the early 90s, when his third marriage failed, with the encouragement of his 2 oldest children, him and Joan connected again, and they were very close until his death. And that meant so much.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
That's nice. Yeah. Yeah. Your book is called Dear Tony, and where can everybody find it?
Okay. Let me just say, I'm very grateful to say that the book is sold out, but my collaborator who I write with, Sandy Newberg, is working on an ebook for me. We just have to fix the format because she's based in New York and I'm based in London, but it will soon be available as an ebook from Amazon.
Okay, and it's Dear Anthony, and it's
Dear Tony.
Your memoirs, Dear Tony. I keep saying Anthony. I'm sorry. It's a memoir, right? How would you describe it?
It's really, I think it's a love story. It's a love story, just a gentle story. You know, there's not much. I think my log line for it is, you know, I see Anthony newly through my eyes, but I wrote the book with my heart.
Right. I mean, somebody's going to ask me, so did you have a physical relationship with him at any point?
Yes, yes, I did.
You yes. did?
In the,
yeah.
Yes.
What was the age difference?
It was large. Can we leave it like that? It was a big age difference.
Yeah, well, Teddy's 22 years older than me.
Okay.
That's hard.
All right. Okay. It's just that, you know, because this isn't being, you know, it's just that, you know, it's an awkward situation. But, you know, when you love somebody, you don't see an age. I never saw that age, ever.
Yeah, in I know. Some, I was 26 some way, and he was 47.
Oh, my gosh. But sometimes, you know, he was more of a child than I was.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I want to thank you for coming on. And now that I have this all figured out, we should be able to do another interview with you when you get back to England. And I should be able to do it without a hitch. And I
good,
do want to talk about,
to
because you are a mortician and in England, and you have some... you have some different traditions over there than we do, but I promised you know, I wouldn't keep you because I know you got a lot going on. Thank you so much for coming on and talking about Dear Tony, and it'll be on Amazon ebook. Do you have a you know, an idea about how long before it'll be there?
I'm hoping I'm hoping it'll be there before Christmas. Let's say that. And
okay.
What a great Christmas
and
present it would be for somebody.
Yeah, he was a multi-talented actor. You know, as we get older, we get a little grumpy, and we realize life didn't deal us the hand we exactly wanted. You know, there's nobody telling you in the beginning life doesn't end the way you want it to. And we don't tend to seize the things that we should have. And we go for things we shouldn't have. And towards the end, you could see he was a little more... thoughtful about where his life had led him, but there is no arguing he was one of the most talented men of his era. He was an actor, he was a writer, he was a composer. I mean, the guy could do it all. It's just a shame he left us as early as it. Yeah, he did
absolutely.
It all. It's a shame he left us so early. Well, I want to thank you for coming and visiting the Lair, and I don't know how much longer you're going to be in America, but happy Halloween.
Thank you. I go home tomorrow.
Oh, that's
so
wonderful. Be safe.
Thank you.
Bring disinfectant wipes with you and wipe everything down.
I will, Mo. I will. And thank you so much. All the best.
Okay. Okay. Bye-bye. All you got to do is hang up.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Redefining Internet Radio one song at a time. DreamStreamRadio.com.
And that was an interview with Susan Selfe. She has a book that... we did this at Halloween, and the problem was, having switched over to DreamStream, it's a little bit different setup than I was accustomed to with my other stations that I had been with, you know, and getting an interview overseas and even over the phone and pre-recording was giving us a bit of trouble, and finally we got it figured out, thank God, and I was able to do a short one with her. But she's going to be coming back because she is a mortician and a counselor on grief, and she's got some stories, and things are very different over across the pond, you know. You can have a body in storage for 6 months and have it brought out once a week and visit it before you have it interred. It's all about what you want. So she's a very interesting lady, and her book is, she's got a Facebook, Dear Tony, and you can find, also, I think they're going to have it on, what is it, Amazon, but it's not out yet in an ebook. That's what they're working on because they sold out, so they're trying to work on an ebook. But I'm going to play a couple of more songs like that he wrote or sang. But my other guest is already here, George Reis. Welcome to my lair.
Pleasure to be here.
Yeah, you said, you told me today Anthony Newley was in Hammer movie.
He was, it's an early Hammer movie, so I imagine this is pretty early in his career. It's a 50s film called X the Unknown, and he plays a British soldier. So when you mentioned that the prior interview is going to be about a book on him, that's the first thing I thought of. And it's funny, because the other day I was up really early, and one of, it's a station called Antenna TV. I think it's a nationwide station. They were showing one of his old movies called Idol on Parade, where he's playing a, it's sort of like a, I guess, an early rock musician, like a 50s matinee idol that goes to the wrong, he gets recruited or something. I only caught bits and pieces of it. But what fascinated me was this was a British film, and William Bendix was in. I'm like, what is William Bendix? William Bendix was an American character actor who was on The Life of Riley, but I guess this was at a time when American actors were very valuable to British films for marquee value, so I guess it kind of makes sense that, you know, with...
Yeah, he, actually it was a mock on Elvis Presley being in the service, and how, even though he would have done anything, and he was over in Germany, and, you know, you had the Cold War thing going on, and at any time, all, you know, Get Out would have broke out. You know, it kind of was a circus anywhere he went. So, you know, it kind of was that kind of a mock about Elvis Presley. It was a very good movie, very good movie. I guess one of my favorites with him is Dr. Doolittle, because he sings in it and he acts in it. He was a very good serious actor too. When I was younger, I didn't realize he had written Goldfinger. And that's, the minute you hear that, your head goes right to James Bond, you know? Amazing, prolific songwriter, really. You're a lifelong movie fan, so please tell our listeners about yourself.
Well, yeah, I've always you know, considered myself a lifelong movie fan. And, of course, monster movies are the big attraction, and that's the reason why I'm on your show today, tonight.
Because I'm a monster.
We all love monster movies. You know, there's we're waxing nostalgia about monster movies, but you know, it's something like I said. I you know, grew up as a kid in the 70s, and watching monster movies on TV, always there's always something fascinating about them, and it always stuck with me. You know, seeing, you know, I can remember some of the earliest movies I remember seeing were on local television in New York, were, you know, the original Frankenstein, Dracula's Daughter, Horrors of the Black Museum, Conga, and things, you know, pictures like that, and it led me to want to, you know, learn more about these films, and that meant getting books about them than monster magazines, and it always stuck. You know, it was always something that, you know, when as a kid in the 70s, you know, it was kind of like for boys. It was always monster movies, Planet of the Apes, Star Trek, and superheroes. That's what I remember. That was like what we were interested in. And
my kids, my daughter was born in 72, and my middle one was 76, and that and Scooby-Doo.
Saturday morning cartoons was, you know, a big deal. Well, I'm a little bit older than them, but I mean, I just remember being a kid in the 70s. It just, you know, and then you'd have, these movies would be on all the time. The local New York stations, we had a bunch of them, Channel 9, Channel 7, Channel 11, Channel 5. They all had their own horror programs, like Chiller Theater, Creature Features, Fright Night, and they'd be in prime time, late night, early in the morning, during the day. We had the 4:30 movie, which showed a lot. The 4:30 movie in New York showed a lot of the Vincent Price, Edgar Allan Poe movies, and a lot of Vincent Price AIP movies, the Planet of the Apes movies, and such. So we were, I mean, the exposure was, I mean, these are the days before cable was really, you know, a necessity and everybody had it. These were the days of the local TV stations where you had 13 channels, and these movies got a lot of exposure. So, you know.
Yeah. Let me ask you, did you ever, I think he was done, maybe, Zachary?
Was actually, as far as Zachary, I mean, Zachary I learned to appreciate later on, and I did get to meet him, and you know, he's still very much, he's still going strong, as far as I know, and God
bless
him
for
that, and because he's in his 90s now, and he's, you know, but Zachary actually, as a TV horror movie host, was before my time. He was in the 50s, and I think the late 50s into the 60s. And he was on Channel 11. I think I believe he got the Shock Theater package of Universal monster movies. So he's before my time. But my father, you know, definitely was watched him like as a kid in the 50s. But you know, and then I of course learned about Zachary, you know, growing up later on. But I never really saw his. You know, he was definitely before my time as far as. But yeah, of course I've come to appreciate him. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, you make me feel old. Okay.
I think the timing, I'm like, you
I know how it goes.
The timing, you know, you just...
Yeah. He came back a couple of times, but it didn't click, you know, he wasn't, the humor, I guess, went over or under, I'm not sure, the heads of most people. I thought he was hysterical whole life.
Great.
I thought he
and
was
if anybody
hysterical.
Wants to see more of like, what like hosting... There's it's a VHS compilation that he did in the 80s called Horrible Horror, and it recently, a couple years ago, they put it out on DVD as a special edition with more footage, and it's just got tons of clips and trailer, and he's doing his shtick, and it's, I highly recommend it if anybody, you know, wants to know, you know, see more of him and what he's about.
There's some of him on YouTube also. You know, so if you want to take a taste of it before you go and spend the money, some of it is, I have to tell you something, without makeup, the man was a very handsome man, tall, but a very good looking man. And he was a DJ. He had that DJ voice, which I don't have. Somebody described my voice as nails being dragged on a chalkboard. But he had that deep voice, you know, and that, you know, so it was different because it was a lot more fun with that. We were talking the other day about it, and you have a site. So explain what your site is.
The site is DVD Drive-In, which is basically, it's just, it started in 2000, so we're on our 15th year now. I'm the editor and the publisher of the site, and I do a lot of the reviews. It's actually, it consists mostly of... DVD reviews of cult horror films, mostly, you know, stuff that's older, more, you know, something, you know, more classic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it ranges from horror to science fiction. We do exploitation and drive-in films, but anything that's on DVD that's come out, we try to cover a lot of that stuff. And now with Blu-ray taking off in the last few years, a lot of the stuff is. A lot of these films are getting new life on Blu-ray, and they're looking better than ever. And so it's just it's like the whole DVD era is what was happening in the DVD era like 15 years ago, 10 years ago, is now happening with Blu-ray, and it's kind of like it's a whole resurgence. So it's like there's a whole new life to the website. So we like I said, it's reviews of those kind of films and news, you know, about what's coming out and what's, you know, what the latest scoops are. And it's proved popular. We've, you know, I know I've gotten, you know, emails and from directors such as Joe Dante and Fred Olen Ray and David Durston, who directed, the late David Durston, who directed I Drink Your Blood, which is one of my favorite drive-in horror movies. So, I mean, it's just, mm-hmm. When I started this website, I was thinking of doing it as a fanzine, not realizing the potential and relative easiness of the internet compared to, you know, publishing a magazine where you had to print up and the expense. So I did it as a website, right. And it took off, and it's just it never let up because there's always so much to cover. So it just keeps going and going. And I, like I said, I've been the editor and the publisher, but I've had a lot of, you know, writers coming in and coming out, you know, and you know, that right. contribute with the reviews and stuff like that. And I love doing it. And like I said, with the Blu-ray, with a lot of these films getting. A lot of our older classic horror and cult movies getting new life on Blu-ray. It's just it's brought a new excitement into the whole thing. So,
yeah, I have to tell you, I have a lot when the VHS first came out. I bought one, and I started recording all the old shows that I liked because I was afraid that right. they were going to disappear. Yeah. You know what I mean? So I was recording, and I still have them. And, you know, now I see they're coming out on, like, you know, Blu-rays, and there's certain magazines, movie warehouse yeah. magazine type things where you can catalogs that you can order a lot of them out of. But I wanted to watch my videos, and I bought another VHS player because there's so many of them that aren't out yet on anything else, and I love them. Yeah. You know, I want to watch them. So I ended up paying $300 for a VHS, you know, and you could buy a DVD for $100.
It's amazing how
something and I'm like,
come back. But I think DVD and Blu-ray is a great format for TV series because they can put out whole seasons and whole series, you know, because they can
right.
fit them on the disc. In fact, I'm a big fan of The Honeymooners, and I mean, I wasn't like, oh, they came out on Blu-ray, and I hesitated a while. It's like, why, do I really need this on Blu-ray? But I saw a local, Channel 11 had the marathon of them at New Year's Eve, and they looked like they were in HD remastered, and I saw how good they looked. I'm like, I have to, I'm gonna give in, and I'm gonna buy the Blu-ray set because it's The Honeymooners. So, and I did, and I watched a few already, and they do look great. So it's just, I get geeky about the quality now. But, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, in 10 years, there's going to be
probably,
something new
probably.
Out, a
I
new
don't,
format.
You know, I mean, they keep saying that, and that physical media is going to die. I haven't seen that happen. I mean, DVD seems like it's been around for a long time. It's here to stay now. Blu-ray is kind of like
yeah.
DVD Plus because it's backward compatible. You can play a DVD in a Blu-ray machine, and everybody's happy, and so yeah. I mean, I just, you know, I don't listen or think too much about it. I just, you know, what we have, you know, I've bought, you know, there's certain movies that I've had in every kind of incarnation possible, going from, you know, a VHS copy taped off TV
right.
to a pre-recorded VHS copy to a 60mm print to a Laserdisc to a DVD to a Blu-ray, you know, so it's
let me ask you, you know, my family, we have been described as making the Addams Family look lame. and that's because my children were raised on watching the old monster movies and fantasies and way back, you know, Blythe Spirit
right.
and all of these things from way back, you know, and the Dead End Kids,
the
East Side
Kids. The Bowery Boys, yeah.
Yeah, the Bowery Boys, all of that. Do you have children? Oh, well, God has spared them.
I don't have children because I'm in my 40s now, and I don't have children because I'm a big hit, so I don't, you know. I always say, I mean, I'm right. like the kid already, so I, you know, I don't.
Well, it's a good, you know, some people, you know, it's okay to have kids. And then there's people like me, and one day my Matthew come in and he says, Billy's mother, Bobby's mother made me pray with her today because we were telling her about the movie, and I think it was right. Salem's Lot or something that they had been watching. Yeah, and I had to go over and politely say, I'm a part-time pastor. Give it a break. You know, I'm not turning your kid into the spawn of Satan. It's a movie. It's a makey-up. It's not real.
Well,
there aren't vampires. There's
like,
bloodsuckers.
You know, like when people know, you know, when you try to tell people that you love the macabre, you love monsters, you love science fiction,
right?
You love horror, you even love gory stuff once, you know, you even dabble in gory and slasher or whatever. It's like, you know, I don't sleep in a coffin. I don't, you know, I don't wear a cape at night or whatever. You know, I'm like,
right.
To me, it's just a fun thing. It's escapism. It's fantasy. It's something that takes you back to your childhood.
Right.
Like I said, monsters got a lot of exposure. These movies got a lot of exposure on TV, and they were always fun. You know, they put out Monster Magazine. Famous Monsters was, you know, a magazine that all the kids picked up, and I still look at them. You know, I get nostalgic, and I pull them out still, and I still, you know, try to find issues that I don't have. So, I mean, I don't think it's, you know, I think some people perceive it as weirdness or you're evil or you're you know, you have a, I mean, that's it's just a fun thing. These movies are just fun.
I don't care for something that and some people call it slasher. I don't exactly know, but if it's something that I think somebody would look at and say, wow, that looks like that might be fun, you know, cutting people up or something like that. It has to be a certain way
I agree,
because otherwise then I get nervous and I look at Teddy and I say, Jesus, Mary and Joseph, somebody's going to use this as a tutorial for God's sake. But I do love the darker stuff, and I mean Poe, anything, and I've got two little sound clips from two movies that are relatively new in my genre. One is from Young Frankenstein, and the other one is from The Burbs with Tom Hanks. I was trying to think of his name. Tom Hanks in The Burbs. So I just want to play these two for a
sure.
minute.
Wait! Where are you going? I was going to make espresso.
Hey, look. Wait. Unconscious chanting. You're chanting.
I want to kill everyone. Satan is good. Satan is our pal.
There are mysteries in the world of which we know little. Strange, frightening, whispered from generation to generation until they become a scream out of the past. woman of flesh becomes a mistress of the Death Master, sharing his hunger for souls, his thirst for human blood.
Enjoyed your little joke last night, Doctor. But as you can see, tonight is mine.
Fred, you really are a vampire. Yes.
Hello?
Hang on.
Hello?
Again.
Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3.
I think we're working. Okay, thank you. Hang on. I think we're working.
The blood that feeds them once belonged to others. Driven by the forbidden cravings of another world, they band together as his slaves. It happened to them. It could happen to you.
I'm sorry about that. Our sound went out, and I'm hoping it's back now. I just played the Count Yorga thing. So let's talk again about, so this is actually a drive-in, the Riverside drive-in. It's an actual place. It's a drive-in theater. And on Friday, April 24th and Saturday, April 25th, you're going to have four movies showing each night.
That's correct, yes.
Right?
Yeah, that's the April Ghoul's drive-in Monster Rama. And
then you have it again in September.
Actually, it started in, what happened was I was saying, my intention was I wanted to see if I could get my own, you know, drive-in monster horror film festival off the ground. So I'm in New York and I was looking for drive-ins in, you know, something I can on the East Coast where I could get to drive to, even if it was far. And I tried contacting a bunch of drive-ins, mostly in Pennsylvania. And the Riverside was the one that got back to me right away and expressed interest. So to make a long story short, in 2007, mm-hmm. we were able to get this Monster Rama Festival off the ground. We did it in September, and it did pretty well. And then the owner and the manager agreed that, you know, we should do it again. So we've been doing it every year, and it seems to get bigger every year. And they work really, really hard to get this thing, you know, to work the, you know, to get this off the ground, you know, to working the theater. I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into it. You know, the staff does a great job, and I do the program. I put together the programming of what's depending on what's available, and I really try to put together
right.
something that. You know, people are going to get excited about, you know, showing popular horror films and then showing lesser-known films. I'd say in September, it's more classic kind of, you know, the older stuff like the Vincent Price, the Hammer films with Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee, Boris Karloff type movies. And then when the theater agreed to do it in April, which this will be our third year doing it in April now. I figured let me change it up a bit and do it like maybe a little edgier. So we're showing more, I guess, even though these are still older films, like more modern stuff, a lot of 80s and horror films and like bigger stuff. I mean more well-known to younger folk maybe, like Phantasm and Halloween and Carrie and slasher films like The Burning and Friday the 13th.
Right.
And April's proved to be really, mm-hmm. I mean, those kind of films for April, we've gotten we get a lot of the regulars from September, but in April we're getting a lot of, you know, a different audience, and I'm seeing a younger audience, and there's like, you know, there's a cult for every kind of horror film, and there's a big cult for like 80s horror films right now, and I kind of
right.
like you know tuned in on that and realized, you know, let me book these kind of films and I see that people for this April we got a film called Night of the Demons, which is from 1988. It's kind of like a horror comedy, and that's gotten a great response. It's really popular. So I'm like, you know, that's like the most, mm-hmm. you know, we're really getting off beat with the films mm-hmm. and stuff. But we are showing, like, classic, like, yeah. Texas Chainsaw and the Evil Dead. So.
Yeah. Evil Dead, Night of the Demons, and you have Demons twice.
Well,
I don't
Demons
know.
Is
that two
film.
Different
That's
movies?
A,
Night of the
Demons?
Demons
is a 1980s Italian-made horror film directed by Lombardo Bava, who's Mario Bava's son. And it's, that's another one that's really popular.
And then on Saturday, Dawn of the Dead Zombie, House by the Cemetery, Toxic Zombies. And it says, plus trailer shorts and intermission classics.
Yeah, the intermission classics are the little concession stand films. The owner of the theater actually has a bunch of the original 35mm you know, concession stand shorts, like, go to the lobby now, get your popcorn and all that kind of stuff, which is really
right.
fun to
okay.
see.
Okay,
yeah.
okay, that's
yeah.
cool. Yeah. Let me ask you, do you ever have, anybody who started any of these movies appear?
We haven't gone
into that realm yet.
It's just with the budget we have,
right.
It's a little difficult, but you know, I'm open to it in the future. But you know, we've actually had Tom Savini, who's the famous makeup man, and Doug Bradley, who the actor who played Pinhead, they showed up just as patrons. They came to check it out. Yeah.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
So it's like it was really cool to you know that we can attract stars, you know, to this thing. So.
Mhm.
So yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is yeah, you know, it's because Terry Soto is a friend of mine.
Oh yeah, he's done
comic book and Superman yeah. and movie convention and stuff. And you're right. You know, a lot of these actors and actresses can't afford to fly across the country for this stuff. And then, of course, Gene Caruso is with the Dark Shadows. The Dark Shadows conventions and stuff. You know, it's actors, they're working people, too. It's a little rough, you know, when you say, can you come to a movie thing? And they're like, yeah, well, I don't have the $3,000 to go back and forth by plane
the
room and all.
That's the big issue.
If you start adding to the ticket to accommodate mm-hmm. that, then the tickets go up, and then it can almost be suicide. You like Count Yorga. We played that. What's your fascination with him with that?
I just think the film Count Yorga Vampire and the second film Return of Count Yorga, when they were made, there's something about them. I mean, it's here you have like a classic traditional kind of Dracula in a modern 70s LA, and I don't even know how to explain it, but it's just very, very creepy. And the actor who played him in both films, Robert Corey, who I actually got the pleasure to meet before he passed away, I think he's just one of those actors who's born to play a vampire, and he takes the role really seriously. And I just think both those films, there's something really creepy about them, and it just works as a perfect drive-in film, both of them, and they're just great late at night.
Yeah.
And I actually got to on the Monster Rama, we showed both films on separate occasions. So yeah, mm-hmm. I mean,
well, I want to play a couple of these trailers. I'm going to play the opening for House on Haunted Hill with Vincent Price. Right. And that's my choice, guys. I'm throwing this one in because I think that is the funniest. My wife is so amusing. She's trying to kill him, but she's so amusing. And I've always thought that was just as funny as it got. The Abominable Dr. Fibes, you and I are both on the same page.
Absolutely,
with that.
Yeah, one of my favorites.
I love that movie. I I don't think it's even just because Vincent Price is in it. I just think the whole concept, of it.
Yeah.
And
it's a wonderful looking film.
But even in his,
it's just so weird for its, you know.
Yeah.
So offbeat for its
time. And the way it's got a little bit of comedy in there. You know, he's dancing with the chick like he's, you know, Casanova, and pouring the wine. I mean, he hasn't lost his passion, you know, that kind of thing. You know, it's a lark for him. And I love that film. That wasn't me. The other one I'm going to bring it up is Curse of the Demon. I'm bringing that up. I threw that in there too with Ray Milland. My husband loves that movie. I like it. I mean, I love it. But
I'd never seen it.
Curse
of the Demon is not with Ray Milland. Is that the film with Dana Andrews?
Yeah, right. Yes, Dana Andrews,
yeah.
Right. You're right.
Yeah.
Where they pass the little paper to him and all that. That's just one of the coolest. So I'm going to play these three, and we're going to come back and talk some more about your site and your drive-in and everything. And again, it's going to be The House on Haunted Hill, The Abominable Dr. Fibes, and Curse of the Demon with Dana Andrews. You're right. Thank you for correcting me. I hate to be wrong. Here we go. And of course, I'm going to play commercial because I'm supposed to.
Hi, this is George Bettinger. Join me for the Mom and Pop Shop every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday right here on Dream Stream Radio.
Help, I need somebody.
My wife thinks she's a train.
Well, why don't you take her to the psychiatrist?
How do you expect me to get to work in the morning? Hey, come on, Bertha. All aboard.
Take the last train to Pottsville and I'll meet you at the station.
The monkeys? Wait a minute. That's been done already.
All right. Come on, guys. He's not into it. He says it's been done already.
Hey, wait a second. Wait. Hold on there. Well, that's my chandelier. Oh, don't mess that up. You're ruining the whole shop.
Let me in. Woo!
Something's at the door.
Hello. I'm Mr. Red.
Stop horsing around. Yeah, but quit horsing around, will you? Oh, boy.
I can't see the dancing.
Let's dance. Double handle, one on the sea, Margarita. Bop, doody, bop, doody, bop, doody, beta.
What thing? Are you gonna be a good dog here? Oh, you gonna be good for a quarter? Why would you be like me and be good for nothing?
Gold. The Mom and Pop Shop every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, right here on Dream Stream Radio.
I'm Frederick Lauren, and I've rented the house on Haunted Hill tonight so that my wife can give a party. A haunted house party. She's so amusing. There'll be food and drink and ghosts, and perhaps even a few murders. You're all invited. If any of you will spend the next 12 hours in this house, I'll give you each $10,000, or your next of kin in case you don't survive. Ah, but here come our other guests. It was my wife's idea to have our guests come in funeral cars. She's so amusing. Her sense of humor is, shall we say, original. I dreamed up the hearse. It's empty now, but after a night in the house on Haunted Hill, who knows? This is Lance Schroeder, a test pilot. So no doubt a brave man. But don't you think you can be much braver if you're paid for it? And I happen to know that Lance needs the $10,000 I'll give him, if he's brave enough to stay all night. This is Ruth Bridges, You've no doubt read her column in the newspapers. She says her reason for coming to the party is to write a feature article on ghosts. She's also desperate for money. Gambles. You've already met Watson Pritchard, a man living in mortal fear of a house, and yet he is risking his life to spend another night here. I wonder why. He says for money. This is Dr. David Trent, a psychiatrist. He claims that my ghost will help his work on hysteria. But don't you see a little touch of greed there? Around the mouth and eyes. This is Nora Manning. I picked her from the thousands of people who work for me because she needed the 10,000 more than most. Supports her whole family. Isn't she pretty? The party's starting now, and you have until midnight to find the house on Haunted Hill.
What lovely music for a murder, or two, or three, or nine.
Who's this?
Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to meet a dear friend.
Nine killed you. Nine shall die.
Your wife, no fives. But you I will kill.
But you can't, Doctor. I am already dead.
Here, how are we going to get him off this? You take his head, and I'll take his feet. Let's unscrew him.
Dr. Vibes, who samples the finer things of life. In his own inimitable way.
Because boils, bats.
Frogs?
Frogs, yes. And because of blood.
Because of hail in the bloody middle of nowhere.
Are you ready for Dr. Five?
It has been written since the beginning of time that evil, supernatural creatures exist in a world of darkness. And it is also said, man can call forth these powers of darkness, the demons of hell.
It is the night of the demon.
And tonight is the night that Dana Andrews, as a daring scientist, defies the mysterious murderous devil cult in a desperate battle against the demons of hell.
Oh, why did you drop the poker?
Red hot.
Which isn't, you know. Oh, my boy, you're as pale as death.
There was something in here.
He has been chosen.
I've been chosen for what? What do you mean?
Today I found all the pages of my desk calendar torn out after October the 22nd. I know why. He died on the 22nd. John, what's the matter?
The same thing happened to my desk calendar after the 28th.
The frightened girl. The master of witchcraft.
You will die, as I said, at 10 o'clock on the 28th of this month. Your time allowed is just 3 days from now.
Skeptical? Don't make up your mind till you see this masterpiece of macabre magic. Because, after all, evil supernatural creatures really do exist.
All right, we're going live. Okay, we played a couple of trailers there. The House on Haunted Hill And this one was Curse of the Demon. These weren't cheaply, you know, they didn't come off as cheap movies. Do you know what I mean?
No, certainly not. Especially Curse of the Demon, which is also known as Night of the Demon, which is that's a British film,
right,
by Jacques Tourneur. And that's considered a classic, you know. Yeah.
Yeah. Teddy turned me on to it. I had not seen it. And then it was going to be on TV, and this was back in the days when you had Reader's Digest, you didn't have cable on, and he says, did you ever see that movie? And I said, no, and it is, it's a good movie. And of course, House on Haunted Hill was a William Castle, who was the great mm-hmm. showman. You know, he would have actors, like, get the audience revved up for the movies, you know? But it's another one. Even as at the end with the skeleton walking, you see the lines and all. But the point is, you're supposed to see the lines. She's not supposed to. You're supposed to by now have figured out that this
right.
is a murder mystery,
and
right?
That's the film where they had a Murgo in the theater where the skeleton was actually hanging on the wire and went down the, you know, in front, above the theater crowd.
Yeah.
And William Castle, he was really, like, responsible for spearheading that whole gimmick era in the late 50s, and also kind of revitalizing Vincent Price's career in the horror field before, because this was still he did a couple of films for William Castle, The Tingler being the next one, before he did the Roger Corman, the Edgar Allan Poe films for Roger Corman in color, which then Vincent Price really became, you know, the top horror star by that time. But, you know, yeah, William Castle was responsible for a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, he was a showman.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Your site is www.dvddrive-in.com.
That's correct, yeah.
And I asked you it before we went live because, you know, I didn't want to put you on the spot or anything. If somebody wanted to contribute as a writer or something, how would they contact you?
Well, my email is reesgeorge@aol.com, but you go to the homepage of the site, just scroll all the way down, and you could just, there's a direct link to my email. And feel free to write about anything. And if you're looking to be a contributor, we're always looking for contributing writers because there's a lot of stuff, a lot of releases to cover. So yeah, and if you have suggestions, and all the information about the drive. In fact, today we just launched the whole advertising page for the April Ghoul's Drive-In Monster Rama. So it's all linked there, so you can go there and see all about it. And I just want to say that, like I said, that we've been doing this since 2007, now twice a year, and we always show 35mm film. You know, it was the trailers and the prints of the features. But this year, for April, we're doing 7 35mm prints. And then, three of the features will be shown digitally, and then the rest of them will be 35mm. So five are in 35mm, and then the rest we're doing digital because Dawn of the Dead we could finally do because the theater now has a digital setup, so we can finally show Dawn of the Dead because Dawn of the Dead is impossible to find in 35mm, and we're also showing a 4K restoration of the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which should look fantastic, and I'm really excited about it.
Let me ask you, because we believe it or not, we only have 33 minutes left. Let me ask you, what if you had to pick your favorite movie for that genre, horror, whatever you want to call it? What would it be?
It's so hard. It's like choosing your favorite child. Really, I mean, I'm just gonna say The Abominable Dr. Fives. Because that represents, like, everything I love
yeah.
about the horror, the just, you know, in a nutshell, that's just, that's up there. Like I said, the Count Yorga movies, the Hammer films, the AIP movies with Vincent Price, the Universal horror. It's just, it's so much, it's hard to pick just one. But that's where my heart lays, is in that classic monster, the famous monster era of horror and science fiction. That's really where, you know, my love is.
Yeah. What about Scream and Scream Again and Frogs? Now, Frogs, that's like the idea that, you know, Mother Nature is throwing up on us. You know, they've had enough. We've destroyed the world and they've had enough.
Frogs is just a fun, outrageous, you know, another, it's just perfect movie for the drive-in, where it's just this kind of ridiculous concept where all these reptiles can just, you know, overpower a man and just get revenge, but it somehow works, and it's just so enjoyable, you know. I mean, and Scream and Scream Again is again, that film is one of my favorite movies too. It's really an off the wall kind of concept where all these humanoids are planted in different sections of the world, and they're kind of taking over. And it's just, I mean, you really have to, I mean, it's hard to explain. You have to see the film if you haven't. And it's actually a film that's got Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, and Vincent Price together in there, even though only Lee and Price are together in one scene and very briefly. And Cushing's only in it for a little while, but I don't think when they were making it that they were really thinking about, you know, they were thinking more of just putting their names on the marquee. But even aside from the fact that those three icons are in there, it's just a bizarre mix of science fiction and espionage and horror, and it's just and mod 60s era kind of, it just again, one of my favorite movies, directed by Gordon Hessler.
I always thought the name limited it, because it wasn't just the frogs barking.
Oh,
back.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It was, you know, it should have been called.
But they called the frogs.
I don't know why.
You know, or anything.
Yeah, a lot of people,
you know,
say that, but
all the animals.
But another film that had a ridiculously fun advertising campaign: a cartoonish image of a frog with a human hand sticking out of its mouth. You know, and that's how AIP advertised this thing.
Yeah.
And it worked. That was a hit at the drive-in. It actually played on a double bill with Godzilla versus the Smog Monster when it was first released in 1972. So.
Right. We were talking in chat in Facebook, you and I, about another movie that came out in 1972, Death Dream or Dead of
Bob
Night.
Clark.
And it's based on the monkey's paw. Yeah, that was a tough one. When I first saw it, I really wasn't happy about it because of Vietnam, obviously.
It's like,
you know,
I mean, Vietnam was still going on when it was filmed. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we were still bringing them off of planes and coffins.
It's
you
one
know,
of the first
and
films,
yeah,
of that type to you know, kind of take Vietnam and turning it into a macabre movie, a macabre story. So,
yeah, a lot of people felt it was too soon. You know, even if they had maybe done it with a World War II or a World War I soldier or something like that, but we were still losing boys left and right and women. There were women in the service, and they were over there, whether people wanted know it or not. It's a rough one because it's based on the monkey's paw, which is an old story, and what it basically is if you wish something hard enough, it'll happen. And what it is this mother it keeps saying that, you know, her son's going to come home from Vietnam, that's all there is to it. But he's killed during battle, and she says, no, you're coming home. You're coming home. You promised. And he comes home, and he's not quite a vampire, and he's a ghoul. They don't quite make out what he is. He's got to have blood, but he's not doing it by sucking it out of the victims. He's like, it was a rough one. The first time I saw it was like, ooh, you know, I don't like this so much. But over the years, it's kind of grown on me. You know, and it's right in where you like it, 1970s, you know?
I think it's great. I mean, like you said, it's not a traditional vampire movie, but it's creepy that he comes home and he's just deteriorates and the family just can't, you know, and the father is the mother and the sister are in denial, but the father, you know, knows right off the bat that, you know, something's seriously wrong and he kills
something's
the family
real
dog
wrong.
And then he just starts to sit in the room by himself in the rocking chair. And then I think he attacks his doctor and it's just the way he approaches getting blood.
Yeah,
it's not a traditional vampire thing. It's definitely ahead of its time. The director, Bob Clark, was, again, no longer with us, died in a horrible accident just a few years ago. I mean, this is a man that directed Children Shouldn't Play with Dead Things and Black Christmas, and then later on Porky's and The Christmas Story. I mean, it's just another diverse director.
Right.
Great, you know, left us too soon, but definitely ahead of its time.
Yeah, and the kid that played the soldier, he was in
Richard
soap Backus, operas and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, I believe he was, yeah.
Yeah, he was in a bunch. I didn't watch them, but, you know, he was in a lot of those different things. A lot of these actors and actresses had very diverse careers, and the guys, the directors, you know, Jack Nicholson, he started out in a Boris Karloff movie.
Jack Nicholson started off with films with Roger Corman, and one of them, was The Terror. One of the earliest was The Terror. He actually done a couple, I believe it was at least a couple. I think The Crybaby Killer was, he did this kind of, he was really young in that one. I think that's around 1960, but The Terror came a few years later. It was also directed by Roger Corman, and that was with Boris Karloff, who had just done The Raven, and he had Karloff on the contract for a few more days. So basically he threw together this film in just a couple of weeks or whatever it was, and I mean you can read the legend about it of how it was filmed, and even Francis Ford Coppola supposedly directed parts of it, and Jack Nicholson was definitely has a lot of association with that.
A lot of people got there. We're running out of time, but I want to play The Cry of the Banshee. That's another favorite
absolutely.
Of yours, and Dracula AD 1972, and that's with Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing, right?
Yeah, we just showed that one in September. This is Hammer Films' attempt to make a Count Yorga type thing where Dracula is in modern swinging London. And it's another film that's like hated by some and loved by others. I'm on the fence, but I just love it. I just think it works. I always loved it. So, and Cry of the Banshee is another Vincent
Price
movie, which is another one. It's not considered one of his best, but there's just something about it I really like, and I think it's a great drive-in horror film.
That's another one where the name actually doesn't fit what the movie's about, but a banshee over in Ireland is the one who harrows
death. Well,
there
are banshees doing that in the movie, so to speak, but I like the title.
Because we started out with Anthony Newley, I want everybody to hear him singing What Kind of Fool Am I? Because he actually wrote it. And it'll give people an idea of what a genius he was. Like I said, I never considered him a great singer, but he was. So we're going to do Cry of the Banshee, Anthony Newley singing What Kind of Fool Am I? Dracula AD 1972, Frogs. And scream and scream again, and hopefully we will get them all done in time, and we'll be right back, and we can, I'll have George give you all his information again, okay? So does that sound like a plan for everybody? Okay, we'll be right back.
Whispers the beast the corpse will ride? Who cries the cry that kills? When Satan questioned, who replied? Whence blows this wind that chills?
What if there is a power that we know nothing of?
He's in the house! Awake, man!
She's bewitched!
Oh, witch man!
Edgar Allan Poe probes new depths of terror. Vincent Price reaches new heights of horror.
H is for heretic.
I know nothing of witchcraft.
We can make you die a minute every day for a year.
I will kill as many of you as I need to.
I curse Lord Edward Whitman. I curse his flesh, his blood. I conjure you, Lord Satan, send me an avenger.
Yesterday, Dracula was the most fearsome being the screen has ever seen. Today, tonight, you could be Dracula's next victim.
Something new, yet as old as time.
Come on, Johnny.
A date with the devil.
Are you ready? He's ready. He's waiting to freak you out. Right out of this world.
Died September the 18th, 1872. 100 years ago to the day.
You who witness it must swear before the name of the devil to keep it secret.
Who knows about vampires, for God's sake?
My grandfather died fighting a vampire. The most terrible, the most dangerous vampire of all time.
No.
The year is 1972. A leap year in horror. A vintage year for vampires. The masters of horror to meet again in the 20th century.
Come to me, come Dracula!
Suppose nature gave a war, and everybody came. The snakes, the birds, the lizards and frogs. And suppose that the polluters, the species on Earth called man, were the enemy in that war.
I still believe man is master of the world.
And then, suppose that the human race lost.
Joan Van Ark, Adam Rourke, Judy Pace.
First of all, we're going to have to try to find our
Stuart and Michael.
be very honest with you. I don't think we will. Not alive, anyway.
You're talking big because you're the only one making any sense around here.
But whether we find him or not, we've got to get off this damn island. All of us, now!
And I am asking to get the hell out of here with someone or by myself.
Joe Hoffman, live every Sunday night beginning at 9 p.m. Eastern Time for the best in blues and ice cold brews. It's Harmonica Joe's Back Porch, only on DreamStreamRadio.com.
Once you fully understand, your life will have to wind down a very different road.
I want to know. How long ago did she die?
She has never really existed yet. You see, she's been assembled piece by piece, organ by organ. She's a composite. Like Keith.
Keith?
Yes, you remember the so-called vampire killer.
You don't have to hurt me.
She wasn't just murdered. If you know what I mean.
And that's a couple of the trailers that we were talking about. Scream, Scream Again is kind of like a Frankenstein story, right? Vincent Price is collecting parts of bodies and rebuilding people.
Yes, kind of like, I guess you'd call them, they're called composites in the movie, but they're kind of like humanoid,
yeah,
vampire, superhuman creatures, yeah, creations. It's,
yeah,
hard to explain. You have to see it.
Yeah. And Ray Milland was in Frogs. That's where I got Dana Andrews was in The Curse of the Demon, and Ray Milland was in Frogs. And it says, what if there was a war and everybody came, including the animals, you know? Incredible movies that people still love to go see. I want you to tell everybody again about your site and about the drive-in event. So tell them again your name, where they can find you on Facebook and on your site.
Yeah, it's George Reis. And again, the site is www.dvddrive-in.com. And if you go on there right now, there's a link to the there's a banner for the April Ghouls Drive-In Monster Rama event that we're going to have in a few months. And there's a Facebook page for that now, too, which just got started thanks to Gene Caruso, who was on your show. He actually got off the ground to me. I was hesitant about it at first, but it's taking off. So that's on Facebook, and that's just called the Drive-In Super Monster Rama page, the Drive-In Super Monster Rama page. So check that out. And I'm on Facebook, too. It's George Reis, last name's R-E-I-S. You know, give me a message. Say hello.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, they can. On Facebook, you go on my page, and he's one of my friends. And if you can't still find him, just message me, and I'll give you, you know, his name and a link to his Facebook and everything. But this will be up on Podomatic tomorrow. And we will edit out the little part where the sound went out for whatever reason, and it'll sound grand. That's the Irish way of it. Everything sounds grand. It was grand. It was grand. And thank you, Gene Caruso, for putting us in touch with each other. How far out is Riverside from, let's say, Philadelphia?
It's a while from Philadelphia. Like, Philadelphia is closer to New Jersey. It's more or less, I would say, I'm from New York.
It's more
so
to Pittsburgh.
My you know, geography of, you know, my explanation of how.
Yeah, it's more
it's
out
like
towards Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh, really, is where it is. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's okay. I think it's incredible. I want to thank you for coming on. It's been fun. I wish you great success. And anytime you want to come back on, you just let me know and give me a holler when you've in
yeah,
September
I would love
if you want
to
come in.
I'll take you up on that. And it was a pleasure being here. I had a lot of fun,
yeah.
And the time just went by so quick. Oh, yeah.
It does. That's what Michael Patrick Boatman said to me, because he said 2 hours. I can't do 2 hours. And then I had to keep saying, Michael, we're out of time. And he says, what? I says, we're out of time. And he says, already? And I, he says, I'm not cutting you off. We're just out of time. I'm only allowed 2 hours in the slot.
Yeah, when you talk about stuff
but it
love,
does. It goes by.
About stuff you love.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Stuff you yeah. enjoy, stuff that brings back childhood memories, things that, you know, like the drive-ins with your parents. Thank you for coming on. God bless you and everybody. We will be back here. I'll be back on Thursday at 6 o'clock for the music box. So I'm going to play my exit.
Thank you for visiting me at my lair. And God bless you and yours.